Look at this family. See if you do not see them as I see them. A mother and a father of all America, who in this modern wilderness of amorality strive to uphold our erring nation on its Christian path. In this dimly lit room, illuminated only by a bare light bulb hanging from the ceiling, the American family is stripped of its cheery pretense and laid bare. The stark lighting brings out every ugly feature in these anguished faces. The mother and father are completely joyless, smoking cigarettes on that old disgusting sofa. The boy looks like he's having too much fun. His deranged smile hints at the makings of a future serial killer or school shooter. The baby is left naked and unattended. I assume that's a cigarette burn on his forehead and possibly the boy's arm there as well. To the right, we see bobbleheads of the Beatles, reminding us what a rock band used to look like. We can assume this picture takes place in the early 1980s when Brian Warner was a child, or perhaps a teenager. The dad is wearing a Nobody Ever Raped a 38 belt buckle, which was a fad back in the early 80s. He's drinking beer out of a can, a bit trashier than drinking from a bottle. The shirt he is wearing is called a wife beater, which comes from a 1947 criminal case where a man was shown in a newspaper wearing a stained white sleeveless shirt after being arrested for beating his wife to death. Ever since then, this type of shirt, especially when covered in stains, has become synonymous with domestic violence and white trash. The wife is wearing a yellow dress with some amount of ornamentation in the lacy sleeves and the jewelry. She even painted her nails, but none of that does anything to conceal her misery. She is overweight and checked out. All four of them are pointing forward, looking at us. I guess the screen is us and we're TV, because we are sitting right where the television ought to be in this room, being watched. Perhaps judged. But crucially, they are not engaged with each other. They find more comfort in looking at their television screen than at looking at themselves and seeing what their lives have become. To the very left, past the album cover itself, on the margins of society, we see the words, "I am you." Written between these words are a few symbols. We have a piece of candy, the same 38 revolver from the dad's belt buckle, a skull, and a spiral. The spiral is a symbol that comes from Cyclops, where Manson writes, "Cyclops woman got one eye on her head, mascara clotted vision she is fed. Cyclops woman can't see nothing at all. She got a pinprick spiral hole." The mother of this American family is the Cyclops woman. You can see she is wearing eyeshadow and presumably mascara, although all of the family members have dark circles around their eyes, which are there more probably to add shadows to their faces to make them look uglier. All of their eyes are these white ovals with tiny little pupils in the middle. You could say that they are the size of a pinprick, perhaps literally, since these are dolls we're talking about. Everyone in this family has a pinprick spiral hole on both sides of their head. They perceive very little of the true world around them, and they're in a constant state of hypnosis, wasting their lives away, staring blankly at the television, and taking in all the messages that the television wants them to see. Indulgence, violence, death, hypnosis, I am you. This cycle of abuse repeats itself, generation after generation, and in looking in from the margins of society on this picture of decay, Manson, the social critic, the iconoclastic rock star, can only see himself. He sees exactly the kind of sick, twisted culture that can create such a sick, twisted human being as him. He didn't break the cycle of abuse. He just acknowledged that he is a part of it, and he perpetuates it. And unlike these sad, miserable fools, he has embraced it and made art out of it.
She's dead. Wrapped in plastic.
This line from Twin Peaks inspired Manson to write the song Wrapped in Plastic, and probably inspired Pogo to include a sample from Twin Peaks at the beginning of the song. It reminded him of how some people put plastic wrap on their furniture to keep the dirt off of it, which is an absurd practice that I was surprised to discover was a real thing. On stage, Manson would perform songs from this album alongside a homely sofa and a tall lamp. The living room sofa seems to Manson to be representative of the nuclear family. The metaphor was striking. This protection, which was supposed to keep the dirt out, would also effectively keep the dirt in. In pushing away the external, the internal only becomes more rotten and suffocated. In presenting a clean face to the public, the private is allowed to fester. Families pretend to be more functional than they really are. Come into our home. Won't you stay? I know the steak is cold, but it's wrapped in plastic. Perhaps the cold steak represents the coldness of the family's bond, the lack of warmth between family members. They attempt to dress it up for visitors, but it's no use. It's like he's begging the visitors to stay when they'd really prefer to leave. Because they can see through the facade, and it is troubling. There's something creepy about the idea of wrapping things in plastic. The idea of meat wrapped in plastic is particularly reminiscent of a dead body wrapped in plastic, like in Twin Peaks. This eerie, suffocated, prophylactic measure finds its comparison with religion. Religion is the rug under which the dirt is swept. Religion is the smiling face of a demented family, a lie for the morally lazy to cling to in lieu of examining themselves. It is the television screen that the family tunes out in front of. This episode of Deep Dive is about childhood, television, religion, and the American family, as they are portrayed in Marilyn Manson's first album, Portrait of an American Family. Marilyn Manson was a project about exposing the darkness in the light and the light in the dark. It was about examining the environment that Manson grew up in with a critical eye. When Manson writes about childhood, he doesn't blur it over with nostalgia as that tranquil time of innocence before responsibility and corruption set in. Instead, he describes it in grotesque detail. Talking about his morbid sense of curiosity about the world's perversions. He talks about getting bullied by other kids, getting beaten by his father, getting molested by one of his neighbors, having his dog poisoned, drinking bong water, and watching his grandfather masturbate. He also talks about being a menace, scamming people, pickpocketing, starting fights at school, throwing a bottle of cologne at his mother's face, hitting her, spitting on her, trying to choke her. Marilyn Manson's impression of childhood is far more blunt and awkward than anything you'll see on TV. While other people would run away from these troubling memories or sweep them under the rug, Manson writes about them frankly. And this is reflected in how Manson represented childhood entertainment. Far from validating the image of children's entertainment as something saccharine and non-threatening, he always emphasized the more adult moments, the scary moments, and the satanic themes. The very things that prevent hardcore Christians from showing seemingly innocuous movies and television shows to their children. He built a whole aesthetic in the spooky kids era around the clash and harmony of children's entertainment and hardcore adult-only entertainment. When Manson writes about television, he describes it as a god, on par with or even the same as the God of Christianity.
If it had said television is more popular than Jesus, I might have got away with it. You know, but as I just happened to be talking to a friend, I used the word Beatles as a remote thing, not as what I think, as Beatles as though those other Beatles like other people see us. And I just said they are having more influence on kids and things than anything else, including Jesus. But I said it in that way, which is the wrong way.
Some teenagers have repeated your statements that the Beatles, I like the Beatles more than Jesus Christ. What do you think about that?
At some point in our past, television and pop music became more important than even God himself. And so in criticizing religion, Manson also felt compelled to criticize television and pop music. On the song Rock Is Dead, he says the famous line, "God is in the TV," which has to be one of the most iconic Marilyn Manson quotes. Way back in 1990, he wrote a song called IVTV, which contains lyrics that eventually made it onto Wrapped in Plastic. As is typical for Manson's early work, it was clearly written as a poem and then given musical accompaniment, so it reads well as straight poetry. Black sun came, changed our name, made our lives this simple stain, drove the children from their chores, handcrafted housewives into whores. Society's snake, it ate our brains, injected poison in our veins. TV minds, hip swing grinds, faces cracked and filled with lines. Black sun came and changed our name, made our lives this simple stain. Intravenous TV feeds, bedroom violence all he sees. Ride the lightning to the sky, stab the clouds and watch them cry. Black sun came and changed our name, made our lives this simple stain. Clouds go by, children run, gulls do nosedives in the sun, water falling from a spout into wanting thirsty mouths. Black sun came and changed our name, made our lives this simple stain. All we do is smite for what we think is right. Sound of mind, bereft of sight. Endless, blinding, cathode light. Television. The great black sun casts its light on the American family and renders them hypnotized. Its light shrinks their pupils and turns them blind. Television is compared with an IV drip, whether for life support, intoxication, or straight poison. This television IV drip delivers a slow and steady feed of illusion straight into our bloodstreams. It's not exactly a novel sentiment to be critical of TV. Roald Dahl complained about it in Charlie and the Chocolate Factory and Matilda, two books that Manson probably read as a child. People have been complaining about TV ever since it first appeared. The term idiot box dates back to the mid-1950s, right when television started to become ubiquitous. People have always known, on some level, that TV is wrong, that it's a vice. And yet people haven't stopped watching it. Its hypnotic charm keeps people coming back again and again. If you put a child in front of a TV set, he won't leave. He will continue watching until the end of time, or until you turn off the TV and order him to go outside. And despite knowing that television is bad for us, we still hold it in high regard. The television shows that we appreciate are always exempted from the general criticism that television is a stream of propaganda, commercialism, and programming that appeals to the lowest common denominator. Manson's main area of interest was talk shows, specifically daytime talk shows like Oprah, Phil Donahue, and the 700 Club, where people morally grandstand about how outraged they are at current events and spread rumors about it, scary things like the Satanic Panic and...
I have known many people with AIDS and have never felt fearful.
You know they do in San Francisco, some of the gay community, they want to get people, so if they've got the stuff, they'll have a ring, you shake hands, and the ring's got a little thing where you cut your finger.
Really?
Yeah, really.
You know, Pat, bug chasing is a real thing, but it kind of takes away some of the thrill when you're doing it with rings. Unless you're using cock rings. Ooh la la. On Get Your Gun, Manson calls it pseudo-morals and selective judgment good guy badges. On these shows, people express morally self-righteous anger, and they are rewarded the more self-righteously outraged they are with vapid applause. Usually it is old people getting concerned about some new trend that young people are doing, like when Marilyn Manson went on the Phil Donahue show to talk about moshing.
I want to know why it is that all of you seem to have satanic signs all over you, and what is it that makes... Does this music cause you to do what you do?
Is that directed at us or the parents?
That's funny. Twiggy? That's your little
does the music
tape recorder?
Cause us to do what we do? We cause the music to do what it does, I think.
Yeah.
I think that moshing is a sign of... what Christians would call the apocalypse.
Great gnashing of teeth.
It's, you know, the culture is just getting more and more destructive, and I think, this is a sign of the times.
These shows exist as a form of pandering. It's moral confirmation bias. The people sit down in front of their television and get fed their own opinions so they can feel validated in thinking exactly the way they do, and not being challenged in any way. TV news has functioned in a similar way since CNN reared its ugly head in the 1980s, and it's only gotten dumber as time goes on. News is even worse than talk shows because they actually trick you into thinking you're not wasting your time. The idea that TV is bad for society is so pervasive that people of all backgrounds are critical of TV, and they all use the same rhetorical imagery of television as the hypnotic brainwash box. The Illuminati conspiracy theorists love using television as an example of the Illuminati's control over the population. Many of the people who Manson criticizes also have grievances with television. Conservative Christians think that the Illuminati, or simply the left, are using Hollywood and television to normalize the destruction of the American family. Whether Judaism is involved in this picture is a matter for opinion. Manson's thinking is less on the conspiratorial side, even though he does use a lot of the same imagery. To Manson, television distracts people from the true destruction of the American family, the social decay of a culture that refuses to be critical of itself, a narcissistic, deluded race of idiots whose fears and desires are only validated and mirrored back at them by the television. The television is an impersonal god. It gives people what they want instead of what they need. Old people like daytime talk shows and TV news because it caters to their anxiety about belonging to a culture that they no longer understand and relate to. Young people like MTV and Adult Swim, programming that you can get stoned to and even enjoy some very offbeat irreverence that nobody older than 40 is going to understand. Part of Manson's goal with his rock band was to give the kids what they need, packaged in the form of what they want. He wanted to infiltrate the world of pop music by making catchy songs that entertained people while also challenging them, and challenging the culture they live in with all of its assumptions. TV was an important part of this strategy. The amount of times Manson went on TV or had music videos appear on TV demonstrates that he's never been against TV. If anything, he's just fascinated by it. He liked watching those daytime talk shows, even if he only enjoyed them out of morbid amusement. TV features on the cover art for Get Your Gun. That person who looks like a chick on the cover is actually the brother of Twiggy Ramirez. It says on the Manson Wiki that he's holding an ear-piercing needle rather than a syringe. funny because to me it just kind of looked like a gun. But I honestly can't tell what I'm looking at. It could be a bathroom buddy for all I know. All I know is that Manson looks kind of cool on that television. Actually, a similar piece of art was used as the back cover of the whole album, which means you can imagine that this is the TV the family was watching on the front cover. The American TV-watching family is also shown in the Get Your Gun music video, except this time they're split up. The mom and dad are watching some Jerry Falwell-looking dude with a Bible, while the kids are watching Marilyn Manson. Key to point out that Manson is wearing this outfit with the pointy hat and the cape. He also used to wear this on stage, like in this clip where he's reciting the family trip. Because this outfit looks kind of witchy, I used it to represent him as the trickster magician in my last episode of Deep Dive, and those Wicked Witch of the East socks he's wearing only strengthen that impression. Not a lot of Manson's outfits at the time included hats, so the fact that he's wearing one in this specific part of the video is, I think, another tell that we're supposed to connect this with the idea of the trickster magician as talked about in Organ Grinder. Speaking of which, later in the video, we have the dad showing off his Kalia penis envy, getting mad at his two daughters for watching Marilyn Manson on TV. Appearing to these kids on TV, he's playing the part of the organ grinder, acting as the dark inversion and counterpoint to their parents' televangelist preacher. Presumably the preacher is speaking a pro-life, anti-abortion message, and Manson is singing Get Your Gun, a song that criticizes pro-life extremists, even going so far as to hint that maybe they should be murdered. David Gunn was a gynecologist who used to offer abortions back in the early 90s. In 1993, he was shot by a pro-life Christian named Michael Frederick Griffin. I have no idea why this trend of always mentioning the middle name of a killer is a thing. I do not understand why we always have to do that. John Wilkes Booth, Lee Harvey Oswald, Mark David Chapman. But whatever. David Gunn was shot by a pro-life Christian. He was murdered in an act of pro-life protest. Manson thought this was a hypocrisy that went beyond the pale, and it inspired him to write this song in retaliation. Putting David Gunn's name in the title was an act of war against Michael Griffin and all the people who agreed with and supported what he did. In the song, he says, "The pro-life I will kill. What you won't do, I will." This song can definitely be interpreted as a call to arms to attack pro-life people, but of course I don't think that would ever be something that Manson would seriously want his fans to do. It's just another example of Manson using music to do what he would like to do in real life if he didn't have to abide by the law. When he writes about the time he almost murdered his ex-girlfriend Nancy, he says at this moment brought him to the realization that he needed to channel all of his violent murdering impulses into his music, and thus use it to create rather than destroy. So Get Your Gun is more of a figurative declaration of war, a declaration of condemnation against all moral hypocrisies. But hold on a second. Let's actually look at the motivation of Michael Griffin. Is it truly a moral hypocrisy for someone who is pro-life to commit murder? On the surface, the answer is an obvious yes. But if you think about it, pro-life people think or profess to think that abortion is murder. So therefore, David Gunn would be a serial killer in Michael Griffin's mind. What is more pro-life? To allow a serial killer to keep killing people in perpetuity, or to snuff him out? Take one life to spare many. Perhaps Griffin isn't really a hypocrite after all. To me, his motivation seems pretty sound and consistent. Perhaps he imagined this as an act of terrorism that would discourage other people from practicing abortions, thus saving even more lives. So while there is a humorous irony to the idea of someone who is pro-life committing murder, I don't think it really constitutes hypocrisy. And that takes a fair amount of the wind out of these sails. For a song that really goes all out in condemning moral hypocrisy, he really doesn't pick a great example of it. But I suppose whatever you want to say about the specific or professed motivations in this case, what we have here is an example of a morally self-righteous person committing an act of cruelty out of revenge or anger. I don't think that this murder was simply a crime of vigilante heroism. What I mean is that Michael Griffin would probably like to be seen as a man who reluctantly did what he had to do in order to save lives, but in reality, I think this guy was just mad in more ways than one, and he did this more out of anger than true compassion. How that reflects on his moral code is pretty bad. It demonstrates that he doesn't really align with the values that Christianity advertises itself with. The Sermon on the Mount values, forgiveness, compassion, and humility. I did some research about Griffin, and it turns out he was the protege of this guy, John Burt. John Burt was a Ku Klux Klan member who started a boarding school for troubled teenage girls. I don't even think I have to tell you that this man was molesting the girls. Of course he was. Look at him. Look at him. His boarding school was called Our Father's House, and strangely, I wasn't able to find any information about this school. But given this guy's track record, I think it's safe to assume that this wasn't a school, but rather one of those troubled teen places where evil parents pay other people to abuse their children for them. So yeah, John Burt claimed to be the spiritual advisor to Michael Griffin, and Michael Griffin in turn blamed his actions entirely on brainwashing from John Burt. So to recap, we have racism, weird sexual stuff, murder, and cults of young ladies answering to the word of a single man. Christian America is the Manson family. John Burt is a lot like Charles Manson, and this is the reality that Marilyn Manson is trying to communicate. There is a fundamental hypocrisy in conservative Christianity where they see themselves reflected in this exaggerated parody, Charles Manson, and instead of recognizing themselves and all the danger of their own cult-like tendencies, they blame stuff like LSD, hippies, and music, stuff that has nothing to do with them, so they're free to not question themselves any further. Many cult leaders like Jim Jones and David Koresh explicitly promote and utilize Christianity and revivalist preaching methods in their strategy, and yet conservative Christians still refuse to acknowledge the connection between them and Charles Manson. Instead, they're much more likely to compare someone like Marilyn Manson to Charles Manson, and that's why Manson chose to take on the name. But what Manson is doing is far more self-aware and honest. He will openly acknowledge his similarities to Charles Manson while also pointing out those of the conservative Christians, the people who don't approach any topic with self-awareness and honesty, the people who those two virtues are completely foreign to.
I found that Marilyn Monroe and Charles Manson, about 5 years ago when I thought of this, were the two most memorable people from the 60s. I thought it was interesting that things like talk shows put them on the same kind of celebrity status. And I thought dichotomy of positive and negative, putting those two names together, represented what I had to say and what I was about.
The original name of Portrait of an American Family was the Manson Family Album. I think this is very telling. Manson here is making an implicit connection between the traditional American nuclear family and the Manson family. Get Your Gun also contains a sample of Bud Dwyer's Suicide, which was televised in full glory back in the 1980s. I was shocked to find out that this wasn't on live TV. This was actually pre-recorded. Yes, local television stations actually played a pre-recorded tape of a man shooting himself in the mouth and blood pouring out of his nose on TV. That's very surprising. Now, I'm not exactly sure why this sample was included in the song, but I do think its connection to television is important to point out. There are many connections to television on this album. In fact, the whole thing kind of makes me feel like I'm flipping through channels on a 1970s TV with all the distorted samples from movies and TV shows littered throughout. At another point in Get Your Gun, he says, "I am the VHS. Record me with your fist." Commenting on how abuse makes a lasting impact on a person's psyche. Abusing someone, especially a child, can create a permanent record on someone's mind, a memory that will repeat over and over every time the tape is played, getting more distorted and wobbly with every use. These verses seem to be written from the perspective of one of the girls in the music video. It's fitting that they're both girls, because girls are the biggest victims of Christianity. Christianity is a patriarchal institution. And even Christian institutions that are not run by men are still beholden to a doctrine that was written by men. This song in particular references abortion, which Christians aren't allowed to do. Christian women suffer the brunt of this decision. The lyrics express the pain of growing up as a girl in a white trash Christian household and discovering in yourself the enemy of your entire family, culture, and community.
I am the VHS. Record me with your fist. Want me to save the world. I'm just a little girl.
There's a part in a later verse where he sings, "I throw a little fit. I slit my teenage wrists." And in the music video, we can see a hand dripping with blood, as well as another shot of presumably Manson's naked body completely covered in blood. You'll notice in the video that there are these words flashing over the screen in a cool way. Luckily, the guy who ran Nachtkabarett.com managed to stitch them together to reconstruct the Bible passages that they are taken from. And what a surprise, all of them are from Revelation, a book I'm pretty familiar with, so this should be easy. Revelation 9:6. "And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them." This passage comes during the blowing of the seven trumpets, which happens right after Jesus, in the form of a lamb, opens all of the seven seals on the scroll which was borne by God, seated on his heavenly throne. In the opening of the first four seals, he unleashes the four horsemen of conquest, war, famine, and death. On opening the fifth seal, John witnesses the souls of the martyrs crying out for revenge, and God promising to deliver for them. With the sixth seal, we see the beginning of this revenge take place, and everyone cowers in fear. Before destruction can commence, an angel appears bearing the seal of God, and tells the four horsemen not to begin destroying the world until he has marked all of the servants of God on the forehead with his seal. This may be a callback to Exodus, when the Israelites painted the lintels of their houses with sheep's blood so the angel of death would pass them by. The Exodus was perhaps the most important event in the Jewish biblical narrative. It showed how God's wrath was unleashed on those who enslaved and killed his chosen people, and how God would lead those people to the Promised Land. A parallel event happens here in Revelation. When Jesus opens the seventh seal, strangely, nothing happens, but a silence that lasts half an hour. And then the seven angels blow their trumpets. This is where the destruction really begins. With each trumpet blown, a new horrible disaster is unleashed on humanity. The passage in question happens after the fifth trumpet is blown and the gates of hell are opened up, allowing a huge cloud of smoke and locusts to rise out of the bottomless pit. The description of these locusts is so good that I have to share it with you. In appearance, the locusts were like horses equipped for battle. On their heads were what looked like crowns of gold. Their faces were human faces, their hair like women's hair, and their teeth like lions' teeth. They had scales like iron breastplates, and the noise of their wings was like the noise of many chariots with horses rushing into battle. They have tails like scorpions with stings, and in their tails is the power to harm people for 5 months. They have as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek he is called Apollyon. These locusts are here for one purpose: torture. To torture, but not to kill. And hence we get verse 6, "And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them." So in summary, the key takeaway of importance in this section of Revelation is that this is a mission of revenge. The God of Revelation is very much the vengeful God of the Old Testament, and after sacrificing his son to save the elect, he will make good on that sacrifice of his martyrs and return that judgment onto the people who killed them. And everyone else too, for some reason. I guess we can call it guilt by association. But he's not content with just killing them. He has to make sure they suffer harshly for a very long time. As for how this connects to Get Your Gun, I will explain, but first I want to talk about the second of these passages that Manson put in his video. This one from chapter 13, verse 10. "He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword." This passage led me down a rabbit hole of translation issues, and I'll spare you the details about that in this video. However, I have also made an appendix video analyzing just this verse in particular, so if you're interested in Bible study, check that one out. Taken together, these two verses are about revenge. Perhaps Michael Griffin taking revenge on David Gunn, or Marilyn Manson taking revenge on Michael Griffin, and by extension, the black collar crowd taking revenge on pseudo-moralists. In the song he says, "I bash myself to sleep. What you sow, I will reap." I don't think Manson meant this line in the same way he would have meant it if he had said it on Snake Eyes and Sissies. If he had said it in that song, the line would have been about taking the fruits of other people's labor for yourself. There's an old idiom that says, you reap what you sow, but in this case he's saying, he will reap what you sow, meaning the consequences of your actions affect other people, not just you. Maybe there's also something here about abortion, and how mothers are forced to reap what other people have sown when they're not allowed to get abortions. Or maybe this line is connected with the theme of revenge. Reaping reminds me of the Grim Reaper. Could this be implying violence and murder against pseudo-moralists? Perhaps when he says, "Get your gun," spelled with two N's, it has a double meaning. Get your gun so you can go out and get your version of David Gunn, whoever that is. The person you want to take your revenge on. While Cake and Sodomy might be the most intentionally provocative song on Portrait of an American Family, Get Your Gun is the most daring and threatening one, and this song, above all others on the album, was singled out for criticism after the Columbine massacre. The lyrics really do read like a diary entry of a mass murderer. I don't want to go into too much detail about Columbine, because I'm going to go in depth on that issue in episode 4 of Fundamentally Loathsome, but as it pertains to Get Your Gun, I think there are some important points to make. When Manson used to talk about the Columbine killers, he would approach it from a couple different angles. He called them stupid and said their actions were repugnant, but he never made the mistake that others were making at the time, acting confused or oblivious as to why someone would do such a thing. To Manson, these kids and their motivations were somewhat relatable. The thought that someone would want to take revenge on a culture of wickedness is not really out of the ordinary. Even God seems to think that's the most logical course of action, because he does it all the time, according to the Bible. These kids and their Darwinian sense of superiority is also very similar to how Manson saw himself in the world, a world of wolves and sheep, where might makes right. Ultimately, how Manson chose to respond to the Columbine massacre was to ask Christian America to consider whether their own beliefs, values, and behaviors mirrored or encouraged this kind of violence. And in the case of David Gunn, they most assuredly did. The murder of David Gunn is a perfect example of the real and present danger that Christianity represents to society. It gives angry, directionless people innocent targets for their wrath. It presents violence and anger as virtues, while claiming to be about nonviolence and mercy. Nothing brought that clearer into my vision than reading sections from the book of Jeremiah for my appendix video. God promises mercy to the Judeans only after taking his brutal revenge on them. There's something a little bit hypocritical about that. So Get Your Gun ends up doing three things. It sympathizes with murderers and even suggests the idea of murdering pro-life people. It acknowledges the parity between murderers and Christians. And from there, it slams the hypocrisy of Christians who refuse to understand or acknowledge this parity. This is what Manson does best. Compare and contrast. The bringing together of opposites and the tearing apart of hypocrisies. To pluck up and to break down. In putting himself on the same TV set, he is comparing what he does to what the preacher is doing. He is the equal and opposite reaction. Opposite, but nonetheless equal. Just as the anger of this man toward his daughter is opposite, but nonetheless equal, to his daughter's anger toward him. For more detail about the problem of religion and its effect on the American family, we can return to Wrapped in Plastic. Guilt is the snake we beat with a rake, grow in our kitchen and the pies we bake. Feed it to us, squirm in our bellies, twisting our guts, melts our spines to jelly. This verse is very reminiscent of that inscription on the CD booklet that I read in the last episode. You spoon-fed us Saturday morning mouthfuls of maggots and lies disguised in your sugary breakfast cereals. Here, guilt is given a tapeworm-like quality, which is fitting since the worm became such a powerful symbol for guilt and other such emotions on Antichrist Superstar. And again, we have a reference to television. Saturday morning television. Manson presents an archetypal childhood family scene of watching cartoons with a bowl of sugary cereal, and he makes it insidious. Children are nourished with sugary food, television, the fear of hell, and the guilt of sin. They are given low self-esteem and a false sense of purpose. In the second verse, Manson recycles some lyrics from IVTV. Drove the children from their chores, handcrafted housewives into whores. Fear of the beast is calling it near, creating what we're hating. It's only fear that is here. So here we have that paradoxical chestnut. The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. And Manson is basically saying that it is the fear of hell that creates this dramatic imbalance in the life of the American family. It's the fear of sin that keeps people repressed and self-critical, which in turn makes it hard for them to uphold their obligations and makes them lash out in strange ways, ways that they themselves do not approve of. It sort of gets to that thing that Anton LaVey said, that everybody on some level believes in the satanic maxim, hate your enemies with a whole heart, and if a man smites you on one cheek, smash him on the other. Everybody believes this maxim somewhere deep down, but they cloak it in forms of false morality and false altruism, which represses man's vengeful nature so that it comes out in inopportune moments. Like, for instance, lashing out at someone you love for doing something completely innocuous. Christianity denies human nature, and fear-stricken, guilt-ridden people punish themselves unconsciously. There was a time in my life where I lived every waking moment in fear of upsetting someone or being ridiculed. I felt like an object of constant scorn and mockery, and that also happened to be around the time when I stopped doing my homework, and eventually gave up on schoolwork altogether and dropped out of high school. Nothing in the whole wide world could convince me to pick up that pen and start working again. As soon as I'd go to do anything, the weight of all that responsibility would bear down on me, and I couldn't take it. My mind would fog up, and I wouldn't be able to think. Fear and guilt are a form of self-sabotage that can spill out into every corner of your life. It's an extremely dangerous thing, a type of hypnosis that people work their whole lives to snap out of. The third verse is a little more cryptic. It starts, I'm only as deep as the self that I dig. I'm only as sick as the stick in the pig. The bit about the pig is the one that's always baffled me. I googled it and found a couple of things. There is an idiom that I've never heard of, as sick as a pig, which means thoroughly displeased, disappointed, or dejected about something. But what really held the answers was Spark Notes, because there's a book that I haven't read, but that Manson has apparently read, called Lord of the Flies. In Christianity, the Lord of the Flies is a demon called Beelzebub, who was actually a god worshipped by the Philistines, the enemies of the Israelites. In the book, the Lord of the Flies is a pig's head that has been stuck in the ground, impaled on a sharpened stick, as an offering to an unknown animal that the boys refer to as the Beast. According to Spark Notes, the savagery with which the boys killed the mother pig shows that the beast or evil is inside each of them. The pig's head becomes a symbol of the evil inside humans. The beast is imaginary. It doesn't exist. The imaginary beast that frightens all of the boys stands for the primal instinct of savagery that exists within all human beings. The boys are afraid of the beast, but only Simon reaches the realization that they fear the beast because it exists within each of them. This brings new context and appreciation to the lines, "Fear of the beast is calling it near, creating what we're hating, it's only fear that is here." Christians are not afraid of the devil, they're afraid of themselves. The last lines to go over and wrapped in plastic are as follows. Thin and so white, thin and so white. Daddy tells the daughter while mommy's sleeping at night. To wash away sin, you must take off your skin. The righteous father wears the yellowest grin. This thin and so white business is another line that's always confused me. I understand that this part of the verse is clearly implying some sort of sexual abuse going on between the dad and the daughter, but I don't know why the father is saying the phrase thin and so white. If you have an idea of what this could mean, let me know. In the lyric sheet, we see the words, "Don't hurt me, don't hurt me, don't stop." What exactly this means, I do not know. Next to it, we see the word, "meanwhile," with a picture of hands clasped in prayer. These images are put next to this specific part of the song, which leads me to believe they are illustrations of this part of the song in some way. The phrase, don't hurt me, don't stop, is a little bit weird, especially because this scene is apparently depicting sexual abuse of a girl by her dad. Not sure exactly what he's trying to indicate here, but it's clear that it's supposed to denote something sinful, hence the juxtaposition of the meanwhile. The righteous father, as the dad, is sexually abusing his daughter and then going to church and pretending to be a saint. God, meanwhile, is doing something similar, hurting and punishing people all the time for no reason and then pretending to be the paragon of morality. The righteous father wears the yellowest grin. To wash away sin, take off your skin. I think the idea of washing away sins carries a double meaning, in reference to baptism and also in reference to how people often feel the urge to take a shower after getting sexually assaulted because it makes them feel dirty in both a literal and a figurative sense. These two ideas are combined together because Manson is making a comparison between these two acts of purging. The "take off your skin" line could refer to self-flagellation, how Christians will whip themselves with torture instruments that rip into their skin as a way to atone for their sins. The idea of taking off your skin also has an intimate and vulnerable quality to it, which adds to the sexual abuse idea. Or perhaps the abuse victim feels so dirty that nothing short of ripping off their skin would satisfy their need to get clean. This could be about self-harm in general, and how people damage their skin to feel better about their own self-loathing. Or, last but not least, it could have something to do with the theme of persona, hence the line, "I'm only as deep as the self that I dig." In order to absolve yourself of your sins, you must take off your own identity, becoming something that you aren't in order to please someone else. All of these interpretations add something to the piece. Well, I think this episode has gone on long enough at this point, so even though there are plenty of other songs that intersect with these themes, I'm gonna have to save those for a future episode of Deep Dive. I'll see you then.